The writer writes, "For it is impossible for those who were once enlightened and have tasted the heavenly gift and have become partakers of the Holy Spirit and have tasted the good word of God and the powers of the age to come, if they fall away, to renew them again to repentance, since they crucify again for themselves the Son of God and put him to an open shame. For the earth which drinks in the rain that often comes upon it and bears herbs useful for those by whom it is cultivated receives blessings from God. But if it bears thorns and briars, it is rejected and near to being cursed, whose end is to be burned." As we've been going through Hebrews in chapter 5 and into chapter 6, the writer of Hebrews has indicated his desire for the Hebrew believers to move into spiritual maturity. His desire for them is to leave the ABCs of the faith and to move on to more advanced teaching. He'd already spoken to them and said, by now you ought to be teachers of the law, or teachers rather, but what you are is your babies, because you don't have discernment. You haven't exercised those things that you've been taught, gaining experience and understanding in the ways of the Lord, and in doing so, having a depth develop. And that, I think, is very common in general. It's very often, in other words, easy for us to receive more Bible study than we understand or put into practice. But over time, if we take the things that we've been taught and put them into practice, we begin to experience the things of God at a deeper level and begin to grow and gain spiritual maturity. So the hope for a young believer to move into maturity is actually a good thing, and that's what the writer has. He's got this hope that those who are reading and understanding the things that he's writing will grow into spiritual maturity, therefore leave the ABCs or the basics of the faith and move into a stronger and deeper understanding. And so that's what he had been saying in verses 1 and 2 here in chapter 6. I desire you to move on. I desire to take you further on into the things of God. And so in verse 3, he says, this we will do if God permits. So my great desire is to move you on. And so at this point, he begins to bring them further on into spiritual maturity. Now, as we begin, I want to slowly develop a foundation that will help us understanding his teaching here. I want you to notice some things with me, and it's going to take a few minutes for me to develop this, but you need to listen carefully and just to see where I'm going with this so that you can understand ultimately what I'm going to try and communicate to you in just a moment. But if you'll do this, it'll help you to understand this passage. I want you to notice that he shifts from certain words. I want you to see the way he's writing. For example, look at chapter 5 again for just a moment. Notice how he says in verses 11 and 12, notice how he says, of whom we have much to say and hard to explain, since you have become dull of hearing. Verse 12, for though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the first principles of the oracles of God, and you have come to need milk and not solid food. Notice first that he uses the word you as he's writing. So he says, you need these things. But in chapter 6, verse 1, notice how he uses the word us. Therefore, leaving the discussion of the elementary principles of Christ, let us go on to perfection. So I want you to see the words you. I want you to see the word us. And then he continues on. And in verse 3, he says us, or rather we. In verse 3, he says this we will do if God permits. But then he moves on to words like those, they, and them. It started out with a you. It included an us. It spoke of a we. But now you have those, they, and them. So that gives you two categories as you're reading this. And you're going to see that he's going to develop something in a moment that's going to help us. We have to ask the question of whom is he speaking? That's something that we're going to be looking at as we go through these verses before us. Now, in verse 4, notice he says, it is impossible for those who were once enlightened and have tasted the heavenly gift and have become partakers of the Holy Spirit and have tasted the good word of God and the powers of the age to come, if they fall away, to renew them again to repentance. So he begins by saying it is impossible for those who are once enlightened. The word once there, that word once there means one time for all time. The word enlightened means to bring to light, to enlighten spiritually, or to imbue with saving knowledge. And so the literal reading would be to be one time for all time spiritually imbued with saving knowledge. It is impossible for those who were once enlightened is another way of speaking about those who have received saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. So once enlightened, and notice, and have tasted the heavenly gift. The word tasted means to try the flavor up, to take food, to fully experience. You have tasted the heavenly gift. The heavenly gift is more than likely Jesus himself, because Jesus is the gift God gave to mankind. You see that in John chapter 4. In John chapter 4, verse 10, where Jesus said to the woman at the well, if you knew the gift of God, even he who is speaking to you. And I'm going to do this slowly, and I'm actually starting to speed up ahead of myself, and I have to slow down a bit here. I'm wanting to take some things very basically for you so I can lay a solid foundation, and I don't want to confuse you. I could come right out and just tell you what's on my mind, but it's going to take a half hour, 40 minutes to get there, so please have patience with me. But I want to give you key words because I want to give you something to think about so that when you leave here, you can say, oh, I'm more confused than ever, and that'll be of help. It's impossible for those who were once enlightened, one time for all time imbued with saving knowledge, who have tasted the heavenly gift. Tasted means to fully partake of, fully experience. The heavenly gift would be Jesus Christ, and have become partakers of the Holy Spirit. The word partakers is another word for partners. They have partnered with the Holy Spirit. So that speaks of fully sharing the Spirit's indwelling presence. They have partaken in the Holy Spirit. Continuing in verse 5, and have tasted the good word of God. The good word of God is the word of God that has been spoken, speaking of the gospel. The word tasted means to perceive, to enjoy. In other words, to have experienced the gospel and found it to be good. And he says, the powers of the age to come. The powers of the age to come speak of the various miracles that have been performed by the hands of the apostles. Those works confirm the word of God. You see that in Mark chapter 16, verses 17 and 18, where Jesus said, these signs will follow those who believe. In my name they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. They will take up serpents. If they drink anything deadly, it will by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. So these works are the various miracles performed by the hands of God that confirm the message, through the hands of the apostles confirming the message. And then he goes on in verse 6 to say, if they fall away. If they fall away, to renew them again to repentance, since they crucify once again the Lord Jesus Christ and put them to an open shame. Okay, here we go. Over the years, there have been various interpretations concerning the few verses that I just read to you. I'm going to give you four of them tonight. Four of them to help you to see how deep this passage really is. The first interpretation, has been presented by those who interpret this passage to be speaking of Christians who have lost their salvation. There are those who believe and teach very firmly that what is being referred to here is somebody like you and somebody like me who has tasted of the Spirit of God, believe in the miracles and everything that relates to that, and have embraced the gospel. And one time we're walking with Jesus Christ, who have fallen away and have apostatized, as have walked away, given up their faith, and are no longer saved individuals. And many of us in this room perhaps might even point to some people that we would say were at one time Christians who no longer are. I wonder how many of you, if I ask you, I might as well, I've never done this before, how many of you know somebody who at one time had professed a faith in Christ and you believe was a saved person that walked away and have never come back to Christ? How many? I want to see your hands. See, quite a number of you. The people when I first got saved, I was in a van load of people who went to the Hollywood Palladium, and the person who took me actually brought me to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. His name is Bill. Bill to this day doesn't even remember a time when he claimed to be a follower of Jesus Christ. And yet he's the guy the Lord used in my life to bring me to salvation. He's the guy who witnessed to me. He took me on the streets in Whittier Boulevard in Whittier to take our faith and to share it with people. I saw him arguing faith with people. I went into the military with him. He and I went on the buddy plan, and he said, you need to bring your Bible, bring a good Christian book. He and I led a guy to Christ who had gone AWOL into Canada, and it's just a variety of things. And yet, if you speak to him now, Bill would say to you, I don't even remember a time that I professed a faith in Jesus Christ. I think every one of us has met at least one person, maybe related to somebody, who at one time had claimed faith in Christ and has walked away. And so there are many people, there's a great scholars who would say that that's what the writer is speaking about. He's speaking about somebody who's been born again and walked away from his faith. Notice what he says. The writer plainly states that they've been once for all time enlightened. They have tasted the heavenly gift. They have become partakers of the Holy Spirit. They've tasted of the good word of God and the powers of the age to come, and they would say this obviously implies full regeneration. So they would say, as you look at this passage, you're looking at somebody who's been born again, who walks away from God. Now, there's a problem with that interpretation, and that is that it doesn't take into full consideration other scriptures. You see, when you interpret the Bible, you interpret the Bible through Scripture. It's Scripture interpreting Scripture. And so that doesn't take into consideration what other Scriptures say concerning eternal life. John chapter 10, verses 28 through 30 says, and this is Jesus speaking, I give them eternal life, they shall never perish, neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. So somebody says, well, you know, nobody is snatching that person from the hand of the Father or Jesus. That person voluntarily walks away from Christ. But the retort to that is, well, it says no one, and I'm someone. So if I'm someone, that means that I'm part of the no one that can snatch me out of the hand of the Father. And so you end up in tremendous arguments concerning whether a person can actually do that. And that's where the church is. Look at Romans chapter 8, verses 35 through 39 with me. It says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword, as it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Yet in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. I'm persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And so on the one hand, those who would argue and say, well, look, it's obvious that these people have been enlightened. They've tasted the heavenly gift, Jesus Christ. They've partaken in the Spirit. They have walked away. They're believers who've lost their salvation. But you have to look at the other side of the coin when Jesus says, no one can snatch them out of my hand. No one can separate them from the love of God. And so that's one interpretation, though, and there are many who believe that, and they will very forcefully teach this passage to warn you not to walk away from Jesus Christ. It's an accepted doctrine. It's orthodox. But at the same time, there are other scriptures that have to be taken into consideration for that to be obviously true. That's one interpretation. There's a second interpretation that I'll give you, and that is some will teach that this passage refers to saved people who backslide. The word backslide simply means you were going forward at one time and now you've returned. You've turned and gone backwards. You're backsliding. Now, because they don't believe it's possible for a Christian to lose the gift of salvation, they refer to these people as backsliders who repent and return to the Lord. Now, that's a very important point. They are backsliders who repent and return to the Lord. Well, there's a problem with that interpretation, because the writer has stated that it is impossible for them to be renewed. It's impossible for them who were once enlightened to be renewed. A backslider can take 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, and apply it to their life. If you're a backslider tonight, if you at one time were walking with the Lord and have turned away from him, as a Christian, you can turn back to Christ. You can say, I confess my sin, and you are faithful and just to forgive me of my sin and to cleanse me from all unrighteousness. A backslider can come back to Jesus Christ. An individual who at one time has been following the Lord and enters into this lull in their walk with God and begin to live a carnal life, that person can return to Christ. He can be he can be refreshed in the things of God. As a new believer, on many occasions, I backslid. And if you'd have seen me, you would not have believed I was a Christian. And I don't want to go through a lot of stories like that, but I can tell you, for the first few years of my walk with Christ, there were some major bumps in the road for me. You know, and a lot of you understand that. I mean, if you were into drugs and you were into alcohol and all the things that went along with that, and now you're a Christian, and people will begin to offer you things, and you're thinking, well, you know, I can drink one beer or whatever, you can understand what I would do. Because I would say, well, you know, one beer is not going to hurt me, but before you know it, I've got three or four or five or six, and I've drunk them all, and I'm feeling terrible for it. And then I'm by myself weeping and crying, saying, God, how did I do that? Backsliders can do that. It's possible to do that. But you wake up and you say, how come I went there? Oh, God, be merciful to me. Lord, forgive me. I am so sorry. So a backslider can say, God, your word says, if I confess my sin, that you are faithful and just to forgive me. And Lord, I claim that promise, and I need your help. But he's saying here, it's impossible to renew them. He said in verse 4, it is impossible for those who were once enlightened, in verse 6, if they fall away, to renew them again to repentance. And so this cannot be speaking of a backslider, because for them, there's no place for remorse, repentance, or a fresh start. So I don't look at this in that fashion there. I might as well tell you. This is not referring to save people who backslide. There's a third way to look at this. Some think this speaks of professing believers who have never been saved. Professing believers. I'm going to develop this with you. Notice how the writer states that they have been enlightened. That interpretation says that they've become acquainted with the gospel. In other words, they are intellectually aware of the meaning of the gospel. That is possible. It is possible to be able to say, I know what the gospel says about salvation. I remember hearing of a Hebrew scholar who also was a teacher of the New Testament. And this was not a Christian man. This is a Jewish man, a Hebrew scholar, who memorized the entire Gospel of Mark word for word. And he taught a class to college students on the Gospel of Mark. This guy's not a Christian. This guy is a Jewish scholar. And he could literally have you reading to him the Gospel of Mark. And he would sit back with his legs crossed and his eyes closed and his arms folded while you read a chapter to him. And he would stop you if you misread the scripture. And he would correct you because his mind was so sharp that he was able to actually correct you if you misread the passage before him. He didn't embrace Christ. He didn't have any desire to do that. I can tell you that there are people that when we've gone to Israel, our guides who are not Christians by and large, sometimes we have Christian guides. Most of the guides I've had in Israel are not. They're Jewish people. But I can tell you that when we go to certain locations, my guide has many times walked up and said, well, you know, look at this particular place here, Pastor Chuck has taught out of Matthew 24, and I think that's a great passage. But you might want to go to Mark 13, and they'll tell me, you know, what I ought to be teaching. And they will sometimes listen to you as you're teaching, and they're listening with interest. They're able to regurgitate. They're even able to speak to you concerning what you said, but they're acquainted with the claims of the gospel, but they've never embraced it. I remember one in particular who's become my friend over the years, and Marie and I actually love this man very much. And I remember him on one occasion. I was teaching at Capernaum in a synagogue there, and I gave the message, and he was standing off to my side. He's a Jewish man. And when I finished teaching and I was telling the people, you need the Lord Jesus Christ because Christ will transform your life. And this is what happened here. He came walking up immediately after me and he said, what he's saying is absolutely true. And he starts to preach himself. This guy doesn't know the Lord, but he's giving this message and regurgitating, saying it's true. You need to have this and you need to have that. And I'm looking at him. And later on, I talked to some of my friends and I said, in all the years that I've gone to Israel, I have never experienced something like that, where my Jewish guide got so motivated by that passage that he wanted to preach too. Amazing. We love this guy to pieces. We see him every time we go to Israel. He'll be our guide the next time we go. Dear friend to us. We love him very much. Yet to know Jesus Christ. There are numbers of people who are capable of explaining the gospel. There's no doubt about that. There's no doubt about that. Who are able to share with you things who have never, ever been born again. And so an interpretation of this passage is that this may be professing believers who have never been saved. There are many places that you can go today, especially in the South, the Bible Belt. There are many places that you can go today that have churches filled with people who have yet to be born again. But if you speak to them, they will tell you that they are Christian. I have lots of friends who have planted churches in the South, and because it's cultural Christianity, it's just an amazing thing. They're able to talk to you about those things, but have never experienced it. All you need to do is watch the Country Music Awards if you can stomach them. And if you watch them, yeehaw, if you watch them, my daughter Corinne loves country music. Where did I go wrong? But anyway, if you watch them, many of those who are receiving awards, the first thing they want to do is give praise and glory to their Savior, Jesus Christ. But many of them don't know the Lord, and you know that. Or you can watch some of the other awards that are given, you know, for urban music and all, and very often the guy will be swearing and then give praise to Jesus Christ in the same breath. You know, they have been raised in a certain way to embrace certain things, but have never experienced those things. So yes, it is possible that people can have knowledge intellectually and mentally, but not spiritually. And so that's one of the ways that this is interpreted. And so when it says here concerning that these may be professing believers who have never been saved, because when he uses the word enlightened, it could mean that they're understanding intellectually the meaning of the gospel. Well, people will say, well, there are passages in the New Testament that point that out. For example, Matthew chapter 4, verse 16. In Matthew chapter 4, verse 16, it says, the people who sat in darkness saw a great light. And to them who sat in the region and shadow of death, light has sprung up. So all who saw and heard Jesus saw this great light, but not all who saw and heard Jesus believed. They heard his words, they saw his works, they watched his life, but they never came to saving faith in him. So when the writer states they have tasted the heavenly gift, they say, well, Jesus is the heavenly gift, but they only sampled but did not fully ingest or feast on him. In other words, they didn't accept Christ fully. They tasted and rejected him and the salvation that he offers. Now, when Jesus was speaking to the woman at the well there in Samaria, Jesus told her to drink of the living water. Jesus said in John 6:51, he said, I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I give for the life of the world. And so salvation requires full participation, not a sampling. Some of us have gone to Costco or places like that, and you know how they'll have people who are employed to give you samples? And you know how you walk through, and you can walk through, and here's somebody there with some kind of sample of some sort with a toothpick normally. And Marie always has me get one, even if I don't want it, so I can give it to her. I mean, I have to do that. She'll say, you need to give me that. I don't want that. No, you need to give me that. Go and get that. Get two of them. Say, no, in the name of Jesus, I will not. I refuse. But, you know, you go and they have a sample, and you take that little toothpick and you taste it. And so that's the point they're making. They're saying that these are people who've only sampled but not fully partaken. And so from that perspective, when he writes that they have partaken of the Holy Spirit there in verse 4, they would say that partaking has to do with an association and not a possession of. In other words, they never possessed the Holy Spirit, but were only witnesses of the work of the Spirit. They can be around when he's moving and still remain unsaved. That, of course, is true also. Multitudes saw the works of the Lord Jesus Christ, They saw him do a variety of things and yet remained unsaved. Not every person who saw a work of Jesus Christ came to saving knowledge of him. Some who saw the works of Christ actually ascribed his works to Satan rather than to God anyway. Remember with me in Matthew 12:24, the Bible says when the Pharisees heard it, they said, "This fellow doesn't cast out demons except by Beelzebub, the ruler of the demons." They saw the works of Jesus Christ, but remained unsaved. And that's possible to do. Obviously, during the time of Christ, multitudes saw him do a variety of things. 3 different times Jesus raised people from the dead, and yet people still remained hardened towards him. Jesus Christ did so many miracles that John says that every book in the libraries of the world could not contain the details of every one of those miracles that he did. He only selected a number of miracles to present to his people so that they might understand that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. But Jesus did so many things, and so many multitudes were touched by him, and yet not everybody came to saving Christ, a knowledge of Christ. And so it's true. You can see these things. You can be aware of these things. You can talk about these things. You can even speak about what you've seen and remain unsaved. He says that they have tasted the good word of God. They heard his word taught. They heard it preached, but they didn't trust him. They didn't hold fast to his message. These are people who have gone to church, have been taught about God, but have never trusted him. Again, that's a possibility. That's a possibility because there are people like that in the Bible. There was a man by the name of Herod. Herod was the one who eventually ended up taking the head of John the Baptist from his body. But the Bible tells us that Herod loved to hear John the Baptist preach, and then he ultimately killed him. He was somebody who actually had a preacher of righteousness in his own jail and often would have conversations with him. And the scripture says he liked to hear what he had to say. But ultimately, even though he was interested in the things that were being said, when it came down to it and his wife Herodias said, "I want this man dead," that was all there was to it. And he sent for him and he said, "I want the head of John the Baptist, and put it on a platter and bring it up to me, so that he can give it to my, I can give it to my wife," and that's what happened. So, and that one interpretation, they're pointing out the people who have heard and have not received. And it says that they tasted of the powers of the age to come. They've seen the works. They know of the miracles that have happened, yet they refused to turn to Jesus Christ. They tasted, they did not receive, and it ends up with them bringing greater judgment on themselves. Those are the first 3 interpretations. Let me give you the fourth. The fourth interpretation is that this is hypothetical. It's a hypothetical case, and it would be intended to illustrate the folly of apostasy. And the reason that it would be presented hypothetically is those who believe they can leave Jesus and return to the Jewish religion would be given a description of what would be the result of such an action. This would be speaking of anyone repudiating illumination, the illumination that regeneration brings. There's a Bible scholar by the name of W.H. Griffith Thomas. And Griffith Thomas says, "The passage is apparently a supposed case to correct their wrong ideas. And the argument seems to be that if it were possible for those who have had the experience of verses 4 through 6 to fall away, it would be impossible to renew them unless Christ died a second time." Now, what would be the point of a hypothetical warning? Well, true believers in Christ would be warned to remain firm in him, which would illustrate human responsibility. You might find it interesting, but notice verse 9 here. I haven't touched on verse 9 because it would seem that that is being implied in verse 9 because he says, "Beloved, we are confident of better things concerning you. Yes, things that accompany salvation, though we speak in this manner." Now remember, I started the study by asking you to look at the words you, us, we. Then it went to them, they, those. And now he returns to you and we. And then here's your large word, the word if. The word if is the key to the hypothetical interpretation because he doesn't say they are. He says in verse 6, if they fall away. And so there's a strong argument that this is basically speaking hypothetically. This isn't the only place that the Bible can use a hypothetical illustration. You see that in James chapter 2, verse 10. In James chapter 2, verse 10, it says, "Whoever shall keep the whole law and yet offend in one point, he's guilty of all." The reason that's hypothetical is because nobody can keep the whole law. So he was only hypothetically implying something. He wasn't saying that you could do that. He is saying that if it were possible to keep the whole law, you still could be found guilty by missing it at one point. But there's no way that you can keep the whole law. Now, in verse 6 again, the writer wrote, "if they fall away." The word "fall away" is to deviate from the right path, to fall away from the worship of Jesus Christ. So the question is, if they are genuinely converted, how could they ever come back? Why can they never be recovered? Well, because they reject the message that Jesus was crucified for them. They reject the vicarious sacrifice of Christ. They ultimately would be saying Jesus Christ died for himself and not for them. And because of that, what they're doing is rejecting him. And they're actually putting him to open shame. In other words, he's deserving to die the shameful death on the cross that he died. And he does that because he deserved to die like that. Four basic ways to look at this particular passage. Each one has its merit. Each one has its merit. Some believe that genuinely converted people lose their salvation. Others say, there's no way you can lose your salvation. Some say, well, this is hypothetical. It's a variety of ways to approach this, and this may seem irresponsible to you at this point, but I would say to you that if you held to three of those four, you're in good company. I think the second one that I brought up is incorrect to interpret it as a backslider, for the reasons I gave you. I don't know that backsliders cannot be recovered. Some believe that you can go so far away from Jesus Christ that you just basically leave him. Others believe that the grace of God is like a long chain, and you can be rushing off in great distances, but the chain ultimately reaches the end and snaps you back. Either way, I mean, there's such strong argument in the body of Christ over, can you be saved once for all time, or do you have an opportunity to walk away from Christ and to return to him? The problem is, if you're saying that the person who apostatized, the person who's walking away from Christ, it's impossible to renew him into salvation, then at that point you have to ask the question, just how deep is the grace of God? Is it possible for somebody to go for weeks, months, even years walking away from the Lord and still be brought back? And I think many of us in this room could say that we've known people like that. I speak to people like that on a regular basis in this fellowship. I do it almost every Sunday in one way or another. You might find that interesting, but it's true. I will speak to people often who will say, listen, I was raised as a Christian. I believed the things of the gospel. When I got into high school, I walked away from the Lord. I get letters from people all the time who will say, Pastor, I listened to you on the radio, and I want you to know my story, and they'll write me their testimony. I get those weekly, where somebody will say that I was saved, I ended up making bad decisions in high school, in college, I met a guy, I got married to him. I receive letters like that, where ladies will say, and I was a Christian, I married an unbeliever, and I've lived for years to the point where I haven't been reading, haven't been in church, I haven't had a relationship with Christ, but something deep inside of me was always aching. I had an agony. And I finally began to listen to Christian radio, and as I've been listening to radio, I've heard messages that have brought me to an awareness that I've walked away from Christ, and I want you to know that I've returned. Now, in the years from the point where they walked away visibly and returned, would somebody say they were unsaved all of those years? Or could you not say that they were quenching the Holy Spirit, grieving the Spirit of God, not walking with Jesus? But within them, there was still a seed of God within them, the life of Christ in them, that when it was awakened, once again, was blossoming into a relationship with him, and they come back to him. Well, if that's the case, then this can't apply to them because it says it's impossible to renew them. That means that it would be a final kind of decision that you don't have a relationship with Christ and you're going to end up in judgment. Because in verses 7 and 8, it says, the earth which drinks in the rain that often comes upon it and bears herbs useful for those by whom it is cultivated receives blessing from God. But if it bears thorns and briars, it is rejected and near to being cursed, whose end is to be burned. In other words, all those who have heard the gospel are like the earth. The rain falls, which speaks of the gospel going forth, producing fruit in some, but being rejected by others. But when he says in verse 9, we're confident of better things concerning you, I think it gives the hypothetical approach some real merit. And that's, to be honest with you, where I am. I look at this as hypothetical. Now, if you don't, that's fine too. You know, just don't ever come back to this church. No, if you don't, if you say, no, Pastor, I would prefer believing that these are people who are lost their salvation, I'm not gonna argue with you about that. If you're somebody who says, you know, it sounds to me like backsliders, I'd say, well, I think you have a problem with that argument. But the bottom line is, there are multitudes who have witnessed the things of Christ and have never really yielded themselves to it. But because of the strength of the word if, and because he changes his tenses from the you, the we, to the them and those, and because he uses the word if, I lean more closely to the hypothetical and feel fairly comfortable with that position, though I'm open to being taught better. And if that's incorrect, then I would like to know the exact correct interpretation. Three out of the four that I gave to you are fairly solid. Orthodox believers cling to them and walk solidly with Jesus as they interpret the passage that way. Me, on the other hand, I believe that he's speaking hypothetically based on what I just shared with you. But all I say to you is, shows you that there's a whole lot more that we need to learn about the things of God. And that's what we're trying to do as we study the Bible.